Everybody, welcome. So great to see you all here. We're going to go ahead and get started. We start with an introduction. My name is Will Llewellyn, and I'm the president of Hartnell College, and it's an honor for us to be hosting this event. We have some great connections with the Salinas Police Department, a number of the officers within that department are Hartnell grads. I'm very proud of that. Former Chief Kelly McMillan is a Hartnell graduate as well, so we want to know that. A number of the command officers within the Salinas PD are also Hartnell grads and came through here, and a number of their officers, and they, one in particular I just want to mention because he just started teaching for us part-time in our administration of justice program. Officer Rivera actually resides in Keene City, but he's part of the Salinas PD. He just started teaching for us last semester. He's teaching for us this semester, and I'm actually hoping to recruit Chief Frese to start teaching for us too. But I think she's going to be a bit too busy for that right now, but maybe now. So again, it's an honor for us to host this. I'm so glad when Councilman McShane reached out to me right before the holidays and asked if something like this could be possible and if Hartnell could host such an event, and my response right away was absolutely. We love to bring people to the campus, and any chance we have to do that, we're going to try to take advantage of it. And then also, certainly it's an honor for us to host this event for our new Chief of Police, and we're just honored that she's here with us. We have a lot of connections, not just because of the education component, but we work very closely with Salinas PD because we have our own campus security safety team here, and oftentimes there's a lot of collaboration between our officers here and also Salinas PD. So we look forward to building up, kind of build on the foundation we already have with Salinas PD and strengthen that relationship. And I think any opportunity where the community has a chance to talk directly to someone like the Chief of Police, I think that's a wonderful thing. Only good things can come out of that. We all live in this community. We're all invested. We all want the best for this community, and I'm convinced the only way that can happen is through events like this, and continue the dialogue, continue building those relationships. Anything that we can do to strengthen all that, we're always going to take advantage of that. We had a very tough start of the year here at Hartnell. First homicide in Salinas this year was a Hartnell story. So anything that we can do to strengthen our communities and stop those kinds of things from happening, we're going to be a part of it. It's been a very tough year for us, because that is the third part of the story that has been the victim of gun violence. Three in 1 year. These are all promising lives. These are all young men headed in the right direction, doing the right thing. They were not affiliated with gangs. They were just caught in the wrong place, the wrong time. And that is no excuse. It doesn't matter. That shouldn't happen. So a very tough year for us. We're going to find ways to honor those students. And in fact, the families asked that the service for this young man, Christian Rosales, be held here at Hartnell College because of how much this college meant to that young man. And we're going to host that event. It's going to be this Saturday. It's going to be right here on our campus, and we're honored that we've been asked to host that. So again, we got a lot of work to do in our communities, not just Salinas, but throughout the Salinas Valley. And I'm very hopeful and very pleased to be part of this. And again, an honor to welcome our new Chief of Police. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Llewellyn. My name is Steve McShane. I'm a member of the Salinas City Council, and I am delighted to be here with the Panthers. I think Dr. Llewellyn's done a terrific job. And I gotta say, I'm also very excited that we're here with Salinas Union High School District. All five of our public high schools are represented today. And to help in that welcome is Superintendent Tim Gudoli. So let's welcome Tim on down to the stage.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for all coming out this evening to support an event that's really special because of the people sitting in this V here. These are all high school students representing our five high schools, and that includes LSL High School, Everett Alvarez High School, North Salinas High School, Mount Toro High School, and Salinas High School. So while some of us are on break and enjoying holidays with family and friends, these folks that are behind me have been working on putting this event together, and I want to give them a special recognition, a round of applause, and thank them for their work. They are the future leaders of our city, and they will outshine all of us tonight as they ask questions and facilitate the next hour and a half. So thank you to all of them. I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. It's a Monday night. It's the first day of school after a three-week break for us. And there's a big football game on tonight. So thank you for recording that game and coming out to see what we have tonight. It's also an honor tonight to welcome our new police chief. I had a pleasure meeting with her before winter break, and we found we had a lot in common. Both personally, we have some roots in South County that we didn't know about. And so that was nice to build a connection and to see her passion for police work in involving the community. A lot of the same things that we believe in our school system, our new chief believes in as well. So I want to thank her for being here. I know this is her second one in less than a week, so thank you for making time for our youth and our community. I want to introduce three of our board members who are here tonight from the Salinas Union High School District. We have Board President Eva Marie Martinez, Board Member Lila Kahn, Board Member Sandra Ocampo, and we have several staff with us tonight. If you could all give us a big wave, thank you. Principals, Associate Superintendents, Activity Directors, teachers, thank you for being here. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Tim, and to Sandra, Lila, and Emery. Thank you for being here. The commitment on the part of these students is fantastic, and the subject matter tonight, I think, is so important. For all of you that are technologically savvy, take a moment to check in, to tweet, to Instagram this, certainly as it relates to the students. I want to give a little background. So the idea for this community meeting was born in an advisory to student government by the name of Evelina Sanchez. She's actually up at Everett Alvarez now. She's at Salinas High, and certainly to Rachel Best and others. We thought we might have a meeting like this at Salinas High School, and before you knew it, it was Hartnell College, and it was district-wide, and it was this connection of student leadership through the city to our great local community college. And I think that really is a special connection. Take it a step further and connect it to the surrounding community. Whether it was the loss of life we had earlier this year, or whether it's just safety as it relates to parking, noise, or some of the other challenges that exist in our neighborhoods, tonight's meeting is our opportunity for youth to engage our new police chief on a number of important topics. In the next hour or so, we're going to learn about not just public safety, but better relations with the police department amongst our youth, substance abuse, narcotics, fear with law enforcement as it relates to immigration. We're going to really canvass all the major topics, and I think it's going to be very exciting. For those of you that just got here, we are taking questions from the public, so anybody that's got one of those pink slips in your hand, hold it wide up in the air. Please submit one of the questions to one of our student leaders, and we'll go through them and try to get as many questions answered at the end. I also, as an alumni, so to speak, of the board, I want to recognize Pat Donahue and other folks that are behind the leadership team of Hartnell College. Thank you for being here today, Trustee Donahue, and to everybody else that's an alumni. It's Thank you. So before we introduce the chief, we have two things to do. ASHC, our Associated Students of Hartnell College, represented by LaSalle alum Rafael Mendoza, class of 2014, is going to introduce himself, and he is going to welcome up each of the high schools as they set the stage. Each high school is challenged to sort of assess public safety in the city as they see it, the challenges that they've identified, and their solutions to those challenges before posing some questions to our police chief. So please help me in welcoming forward Rafael Mendoza, the president of Associated Students of Hartnell College. Rafael?
First of all, I'd like to thank all you guys for being here today and such a wonderful event for the community. Like Steve mentioned, my name is Rafael. I'm a student body president here at Hartnell College. And what I would like to do is introduce each high school individually and the topics they'll be discussing. So first of all, we have North Salinas High School, which will be discussing public safety, law enforcement, and
by the Viking Creed and SHS. Never give up, staying focused, honoring yourselves and others, and staying positive. Throughout our history, we have prided ourselves with our tremendous school pride as students proudly wear their scarlet red and Columbia blue. Hispanic and Asian students are our most prevalent ethnic groups on campus. Our Viking family of 2,200 students, along with our 160 staff members, are always able to come together during hardships and address the issues that affect not just one person, but everybody. We welcome you to NSHS and invite you to visit our North Salinas High School ASB class. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Kelly Carpenter, and I am ASB president at North Salinas High School. Our community expectation is that the Salinas Police Department Police Department will help reduce the amount of homelessness throughout the city. We would like the officers to help direct the homeless and to the proper care they need. The reason we feel very strongly about this issue is because our school has a large homelessness population. Our school, through our community liaisons, donates school supplies, food, and clothing to our families in need. We would like to recommend that the police department partners with several churches in our community to create a more clean and safe environment. Ideally, we would appreciate a stronger push from the police to find a place for homeless people to rehabilitate themselves into society. Our question that we have is how the police department is going to enforce the homelessness. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Salinas. So second of all, we have Salinas High School, which will be discussing questions regarding gang violence.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Rachel Best. I'm the ASB president at Salinas High School. So Salinas High School is the first public high school established in Salinas in the year 1882. While much of the school has been renovated in the last 20 years, making it even more beautiful, two things have remained the same since the Salinas High start: our iconic bell tower and astonishing amount of school pride. Both contribute to the things that make our school so great. Our student body is comprised of amazing students of all races and genders who are ready to learn and succeed. Being a part of Salinas High means acting safe, honorable, and sensible inside and out of school because it's the cowboy way.
My name is Nicole Ellis, and I'm Salinas High's ACU Vice President. Thanks. Our expectation is that students feel safe coming to and leaving school. While we don't feel that Salinas High at the school has much of a problem with gang violence, the issue should definitely be something to address immediately to keep students in all schools safe and protected both in school and in the community. We would like to see the Salinas Police Department work with our community to produce a more positive environment in Salinas High, partnering with schools and demonstrating through actions that they will protect all citizens and work with all communities to help curb the gang violence spread throughout the city. We also suggest creating a gang unit that can assist in reducing gang membership and help direct members to a more positive place in the community.
And our question for our police chief regarding gang violence is, how will you prevent our kids from joining more gangs? And what do you need from us to help you accomplish your goals?
High school student leaders that will be discussing narcotics, drugs, and substance use. So round of applause, please. You're welcome then.
Good evening. My name is Faith Cowich. I'm a teen mom, and I'll be graduating from Mount Toro this year as a Mount Toro High School serves as an alternate and voluntary opportunity for students to earn a high school diploma in the Salinas Union High School District. Regardless of where a student is academically and emotionally, Mount Toro High School is committed to being a school that embraces diversity and works to inspire and support students to be more motivated, organized, respectful, engaged, productive, and educated members of our society. Mount Toro High School was established in 1964 in a warehouse on Vernon Avenue. In 1990, it moved to our current location in Central Salinas on Sherwood Drive, where it holds a 221 student capacity. Since 2012-2013, school year, the academic structure consists of solely a diploma program and an 8-5-week learning cycles. The learning cycles include academic and emotional support, direct instruction, positive behavior, and curricular intervention. As students complete the graduation requirements, new students are enrolled in their place to allow opportunity for others who may benefit from alternate education.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Cesar Medina, and I'm a student at Mount Toro, and I'm going to graduate in about 2 to 3 months, and hopefully attend college. A community issue that Mount Toro High School will address is substance abuse. Our community expectations is that Salinas Police Department will assist to build and maintain substance abuse awareness in the community by collaborating, participating, and being proactive with public agencies, schools, community events, parents, and students. In addition, Salinas police officers should have a proper training and awareness in order to approach, communicate, and treat individuals who suffer from substance abuse issues, mental health, and physical disabilities. Lastly, we expect that more funds are allocated for community policing efforts and strategies in peace and more Salinas. Our community recommendations are as follows. Salinas Police Department will collaborate with Probation Department, Public Health agencies, and Salinas School District to conduct substance abuse workshops for both students and parents. 2. Build community awareness by supporting substance abuse educational programs and recovery programs. 3. Police officers will visit recreational
centers and the tribal community members in order to build awareness and trust from the community.
Our question is, what strategies are Salinas Police Department going to pursue to improve community policing?
So up next we have Alvarez High School that will be discussing building trust, overcoming lack and police. Sorry, it's a typo. But please welcome them upstage. How are you?
So good evening, everybody. My name is Marissa Pombo, and I am ASB president at Everett Alvarez High School. Everett Alvarez High School was established in 1995, named in honor of an admirable former U.S. Navy commander, Everett Alvarez Jr. Our school flourishes with intense diversity, from our 2,600 students to our countless clubs and society on campus, each distinct in their very own ways. Everett Alvarez is known for its community outreach and dedication to greater causes, such as promoting breast cancer awareness and raising funds to end ALS, not only focusing on community service, but also empowering the youth. The school succeeds primarily in making each student feel empowered by their intelligence and their integrity, thanks to our helpful 180 staff members. It is needless to say that every student at Everett Alvarez High School proudly follows the legacy of Everett Alvarez Jr., succeeding academically to serve their community with respect, responsibility, and with honor. Just what it means to have equal pride.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Paige. I am the ASB treasurer at Everett Alvarez High School, and we're going to be discussing the issue on trust within our police and our society. So our expectation for the police department is to have continuous involvement with the community, whereas this may include citywide events and gatherings that will help promote unity between the citizens and those who work to ensure our safety. At this point, the vast majority of interaction involved between law enforcement and the citizens is primarily negative and usually crime-based. We hope to see the police department jump on opportunities to create a more positive relationship within the community. We're very excited to see how you can change the city, and some of the recommendations that we've come up with include more PAL activities and collaboration with the law enforcement and the community to expand at large with these programs. Another recommendation we've thought of is the direct involvement with schools ranging from elementary and high school to show students and the future generations that your purpose is to maintain a safe community here. One of the questions that we also came up with will be, based on everything that has happened recently and has been broadcasted nationwide concerning law enforcement and the issues with trust, how do you guys plan to strengthen the trust between citizens and the police?
And another question that we have here is, do you think that ensuring the safety of those in the city of Salinas by any means necessary is so important that you are willing to sacrifice the trust within the community? Thank you.
Finally, we have the LSL High School Trojans as they'll be discussing immigration, fear, and law enforcement. Please give a round of applause.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Adam Reno, and I will be representing LSL High School. Also, high school has had a lasting impact on East Salinas since 1965. We are the heart of East Salinas, serving the community countless hours each day, year-round. Also is considered home to many as it is a safe environment for students to grow and flourish. ALSA High School serves 2,700 students, 170 staff members, and numerous community organizations outside of the school day. Our population consists of students that are responsible, respectful, and safe. Be on the lookout each year during November when ALSA exceeds its previous year's goal by donating pounds of food to the Monterey County Food Bank. This year, we donated 16,000 pounds of food.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Angel Castillo, and I am proudly representing ALSA High School. The community-centered issue we are representing is immigration. Our expectation is that law enforcement will provide a safe environment for all, regardless of race, citizenship, gender, etc. We expect that our community will live without fear of harassment or discrimination. We expect law enforcement to support positive activities that raise awareness in our community. Our recommendations are as follows. First, we would like law enforcement presence during positive community activities and events. Second, positive law enforcement interactions such as greeting people with a smile or hello. And last but not least, frequent positive community interactions such as visits to youth centered after school programs. Thank you for this opportunity of representation. We appreciate it greatly. One of our questions is, how do you expect to earn the respect of Salinas citizens?
Another question we would like to ask is, what are your personal goals now that you hold the title of Salinas Police Chief? Thank you.
Wow, what some tremendous representatives. If you've ever had children or raised children or worked with children, I think we all can say that we're convinced these young adults are great representatives for the Salinas, so please help me give them a round of applause. In addition to all these schools, I just want to give a shout out to all the advisors, whether it's Margaret at North Salinas or Mark at Salinas High, Fabian at Mount Toro, Sky at Alvarez, and also Tiffany at El Sal. Really, this was a great way of shaping this, and I want to thank all the advisors that have really made ASP what it is. So, Blanca, and we have, I got Tiffany and Blanca from of course. So it does take the district, Salinas Union High School District, to make all this happen, and to Blanca and the leadership she provides in keeping our students together. And I see Evelina just showed up. I gave her a little bit of a shout out earlier, but I just want to say thank you as you helped make this possible as well. So now the vote we all came for, and that is an opportunity to meet our police chief. So the way that we're going to go about this is I'm going to introduce her, and she's going to just introduce herself. She's going to give you some background on who she is, where she comes from, and what her vision is for the department. And then some of those questions that were crafted from each of these high schools will once again be repeated. So I will go ahead and circulate the mic. For any of you that have those pink slips and you would like a question asked, please pass it down, and maybe I'll call on Sky or Mark to help collect those, and then we'll go through some of the questions. I see a number of city leaders here as well. I see Bernice House. She's on our LCS. Albert Fong. Rick Giffen's a planning commissioner. Wes White, you're on a commission.
Airport.
Airport commission. I'm glad to see you. And former council member Sergio Sanchez is here. And I just caught eye with our president of the Salinas Police Officers Association, Gabe Carvey. So thank you for being here. This is great. So with that, Salinas is very excited about the new leadership that we've got in our new police chief. A very, very lengthy and exhaustive process took place to interview many, many, many folks that brought together a woman that's got a vision, she's got commitment, she's got experience in big departments, small departments, but most of all, she's committed to youth. And I think that's what resonated most when I had the opportunity to visit with her. Not only is she a mom of young adults, but she's also believing very, very much in the future that our young adults present today. And I brought this idea up with her. She jumped on it right away. So please help me for a few remarks on her vision for the Salinas Police Department. A little bit of an introduction. Chief Adele Frese of the Salinas Police Department.
What a welcome. Thank you so much for having me here at Hartnell College. And thank you, students of all five high schools. I am very inspired by your leadership. It works both ways. I'm not just here trying to provide mentorship and role modeling. I get back in return your good positive energy, your great thoughts. I'm just so impressed by the turnout here this evening. And how about we acknowledge Councilmember McShane for also putting this together. Thank you. Can everyone hear me okay? Great. So first of all, I know many of you have been told or read or have heard me say that I have spent my law enforcement career primarily in Texas, but I do want you to know that I'm a native of the Bay Area, and I grew up in a town called San Lorenzo. My family's mostly from Oakland, but my mother is from King City. She's deceased now. She died of cancer. My father just moved out of Oakland after living there for 75 years. He's moved on to Manteca now. And I have many living brothers and sisters. So I'm one of seven children. I also want to help you learn how to say my name properly, because some people make it sound so beautiful and eloquent, but it's not that grand, actually. It rhymes with a word that many of you students should be familiar with. What do you do in your literature class? Other than read, you must write essays. So my name rhymes with essay. It's Frese. Super simple now, right? Got it. Okay. So back to the Bay Area. I want to let you students know that I can relate very much to where you are. How many of you are 18 years old? Raise your hand. Raise it proud, proudly. Believe me, you'll never go back to 18 again. So 17 years old, raise your hand. Okay, great. All right. I was 18, and I was living in my hometown. I grew up on a very busy street. Some of you have been through the Bay Area, know a street called Hesperian Boulevard. Maybe. It runs off of 880. My house was not off of Hesperian, it was on Hesperian Boulevard. So I had to cross eight lanes to get to the other side of the street. So I guess it was only natural that I be destined for public safety, because I was trained in traffic safety since I was born, just trying to get to the other side of the street. But when I was 18, my girlfriend, Julie, was down the street from my house at a neighborhood park, and she was abducted and she was murdered. So I give you this story to let you know in very short order that I am passionate about public safety and the safety of all of you students and the safety of our community. It's very important to me that everyone knows everything they possibly can to stay safe, and that I lead a police department that is not only continuing this dialogue with you, but also do the same things to protect our community members. This story that I shared impacted my life very, very much. I couldn't sleep well for 2 weeks. My friend was gone by a violent predator. I have given so many talks throughout my career to help young people stay safe and understand personal safety. But I'm here before you sharing this story, mostly so you understand my passion and my commitment to making you safe. So while I hear some of these questions tonight, and I'll do my best to understand the questions and answer them, One thing I've learned about policing, it is fundamentally, there are fundamentals that never change, but yet to stay current with the times and fighting crime, it is an ever-changing, it's an ever-changing industry and service. And I have only been here 1 month, so I'll do my best to answer all of the questions, but I don't have a finite master plan, but I will do my best to express exactly what our resources are today to deal with the issues at hand. Let's see, a little bit also about myself, as I am a mother, that's correct, as the council member shared with you, I have two young adult sons, but I also have two younger children who may end up going through this college right here, and that would be great. So I am a mother of four. I have three sons and one daughter. We live and we do our living here. We don't live technically within the city limits, but we do all of our living right here in the city of Salinas. I think I'm out of time about me, so I will hand over the mic to the first person to pose the question.
Yeah, that's perfect. Okay, thank you, Chief. Let's give the Chief a round of applause for that big introduction. And to each of our ASB leaders, I just want to ask that you'll need to restate your question. So we'll start with North Salinas High School. And I'm sure there's a few other questions as well, so we'll just pass the mic around. It's really hefty, so just hold it. Yeah.
So our question is, how is the police department going to... How is the police department going to enforce our homelessness laws?
Homelessness, and as you know, we have many challenges ahead with our homelessness here in Salinas. There is not a one size fits all answer for this problem that really has plagued the entire country. I believe in partnering with as many services as possible to bring services to our homeless people. So traditionally what goes on in policing is we have services and we ask people to come to us or to go to a certain place. Oh, thank you. You guys treat me like gold. Thank you. What we're finding is more effective is that we team up with social service providers, adult protective services, and a plethora of services that are out there, including clergy. And I heard that was a suggestion, which is a great suggestion. And we do a team approach where we actually invite workers to schedule with police and get in a police car together, and we go out and we contact those who are, I don't want to say most at risk, but those who are most difficult to serve. As many of you probably know, we can offer services, but sometimes people don't want to accept them because it's a little bit out of their comfort zone. So I think as we make progress with our homelessness, we're going to find that the greatest challenge will be those who refuse services. So we're going to find ways to reach them. And there are some models out there that are showing positive impacts. They're showing quite a bit of progress. Monterey, the city of Monterey, is one of them that is doing this team approach. Officers get with a service provider, they make the arrangements beforehand, and they team up and they go out. And sometimes they have to park their car and go out on foot and go into the brush, because the officer usually knows where, you know, where the different people are set up or set up camp. And so together we reach out to the individuals and we try to get them to come with us, to come along and accept services. We really are finding more and more ways to soften our approach, because ultimately we also want, we want our homelessness to be reduced. We want homeless individuals to have shelter. We cannot make people go into a place they don't want to go to. You understand that, if they're not breaking the law. So we have to respect those boundaries as well.
Rachel from Salinas High School, you want to repeat your question regarding gang violence? Yeah, just give it a second.
Okay, all right, there. Okay, so our question related to gang violence is, how do you plan to deter youth from turning to gangs, and how can we help you with this?
Thank you for both pieces of that question, or the question and the offer. As you know, most people who seek gang life start out with a desire to be recognized, a desire to be valued. Do we all agree with that? So often you have, you know, 10, 11, 12 year old kids who just don't feel like they're a part of anything of value and strength. So we want, as police, this is something that police officers get so much fulfillment out of, and that is reaching a young person and redirecting them away from crime, away from risk, and bringing them, you know, under our wings and guiding them to the right path. This is something that gives us tremendous value in our jobs. So the dialogue has begun and it will continue to grow in our department, where we talk a lot about how we can do this more effectively, how we can make a greater impact on the lives of young children to divert them from joining gangs in this city. We all know, we've heard it before, it starts at home. And that is so important. So when you ask me what you can do to help, I would say at this point in your life, if you have younger brothers and sisters, or if not, if you can provide mentorship to young people, and I'm talking, you know, elementary school age, middle school age, do everything you can to dissuade them from joining a gang. Petition us, your city leaders, as much as possible to provide as many activities and outlets as you possibly, as often as you can. I would suggest that you just bug us about that. Say, we want more. You know, we need more. Our children need more activities. We have some programs, and I use the term very carefully, because programs aren't the be-all and end-all. We have to really understand what we're reaching when we reach out and to young people, and we direct them into a program like the Police Athletic League, like our Police Explore program, so we can reach a small segment of our population. But we don't only target those who are at risk. We open our doors to everyone, of course. So, you know, that is something we're going to continue to grow at Salinas Police Department. Our programs, like the Police Athletic League, that engage young people. And we want to reward them for their good behaviors. So some of the things that I've done in the past and I plan on doing here, in fact, our POA president sitting up there, I'm going to point him out since he was making faces at me earlier. One of the things that we've talked about is finding new ways to lure children, kind of like predators do, but in a positive way. We want to prey on children and try to bring them under our wing. For example, handing out little vouchers for kids to come to the police department or to an assembly point area where they would sit down at a designated time. They would come to us and they turn in their voucher because a police officer gave them this voucher, and they come and they get a free ice cream. But they have to sit there with their ice cream and then visit with the police officer. I've done this in other cities. And it sounds like, really, you do that? No, really, we do that. And our kids just love it. They love to have that moment where they get to sit down with the police officer and find out that that person is a real person. That person could be a big brother to our young people out there. So this is just one small program. When I mentioned programs, ways that we can lure children, and I use those words to our benefit. We want to lure children to have some face time with them and have a conversation and ask them how things are going at home. You know, is there anything that's bothering you these days? You know, some kids flat out will tell us, somebody is bugging me. And before you know it, we'll hear stories about how they're being pressured into joining gangs or going in the wrong direction. And we can divert that. But this dialogue needs to happen with everyone. Everyone who encounters a young person, please do everything you can to provide mentorship, role modeling, and coaching to our young people. The old expression or term, it takes a village to raise a child, I know that's been debunked. I stand by it, I always have. It takes all of us to watch our kids and to help guide them along. You might say, well, those are someone else's kids. Yes, but they may be the one graffitiing on your fence someday at your house, so it matters. We all just need to contribute. Be a big brother, be a big sister.
Okay, next we have Mount Toro High School with a question about narcotics, drugs, substance abuse perhaps, or whatever it is you want to ask. Mount Toro?
Our question is, what strategies are the Salinas Police Department going to pursue?
Thank you for that question. And by the way, congratulations to both of you. I know you're gonna graduate early. Good job, that must have taken a lot of hard work. Community policing strategies, well, where do I begin? You may have to cut me off. First, you need to understand that I've only been here a month, so rather than picking the ball up mid-court, I want to roll it back to the starting line, and I want to make sure that my own department and I share the same philosophy about community policing. And what that means to me is first we have to make sure that we are practicing the philosophy within our police department. That means I have to empower, enable, encourage, and value the talents, the skills, the abilities, the creativity and imagination of each and every one of our employees, our police officers and our non-police employees. I have to encourage them to be able to make decisions for the good of the situation they're dealing with. And once we get that down pat, then I have to make sure the supervisors and our management are all in sync. Because what I want them to do is I want them to go out on the street and apply that same, those same principles when they're interacting with the public. I want them to see a problem and go, you know what? I have the resources to fix this. But it's never been done this way before. But that's okay because we have a department that supports the ability to use creative means to work with the community to solve issues. So we have a pretty long road ahead to build community policing, to strengthen it. Because first I have to start from the very basics, and that is empowering all of the officers on the department to make decisions, encourage them, and let them know they're not going to get in trouble for trying something new to solve a problem. And then all of our officers are going to be told over and over that we value their efforts to build relationships with community members. So one of the things I used to do when I was a lieutenant and then later a commander, as I would drive around, I would start in one district and I would make a roll call, a police briefing. And I would tell the officers that I'm gonna go into a place of business and I'm gonna ask them if they know the police officer's name who works at this beat. And they need to know your name. So I would do that. I would randomly stop different businesses and I would ask, who's your cop? And sometimes they would pull out business cards and this is him right here. Or, oh, that's so, some of them would know them much more than I ever imagined they could know a beat officer, and some didn't know their officer at all. So eventually there was not a business that I would go to who didn't know their police officer. So we're going to encourage and we're going to reward our officers for building relationships with the community.
And then, thank you. Yeah, that's good. And then last, we have Alvarez High School with a question as well. Alvarez. Oops. Okay. And then Alvarez.
Okay, so our question was, based on everything that has happened recently and has been broadcast nationwide, like on the media, concerning law enforcement, how do you plan to strengthen the trust between the citizens and the police of Salinas?
Well, you just heard of the foundation for it. Providing forums for people to speak, I think, is very important. I think it's dangerous when police begin to assume they know what all factions of the community expect or want or think. So, you know, we are going to continue to provide forums throughout the city. This is only my second community meeting. I mean, I am barely getting rolling out here. So bear with me, but I'm going to make my way all around this town. We're going to have many, many opportunities provided to residents in this community to come to a microphone or to have smaller group meetings, and we're going to solicit input. The other thing we're going to do that's pretty effective, and I mentioned this at the town hall meeting last week, is doing community survey. So a community survey that I plan to do will call for the officers and to assemble small team, many small teams. There'll probably be about a dozen of them. And it'll take several weeks to do this, but we'll actually go throughout the city to every neighborhood, and we'll pick random houses. We'll let the computer actually pick the random houses. And we'll knock on the doors face to face, and we'll have conversation at the doorsteps of our residents, so that, again, going that extra yard, if you will, to meet people at their homes. And we're going to knock on doors, and we're going to ask questions about what they think, what their perception of crime is in the city, what their fears are, what their concerns are, and what they'd like to see addressed. And of course, at the end of every survey, I like to ask them, what are you going to do to help us? So those are my key components to building trust with our community.
Thank you, Chief. And now for Allisaw High School for the final question.
Do you mind if we ask two? Okay. So our first question is, how do you expect to earn the respect or trust of the Salinas citizens?
So we're getting a little overlap here somehow. So some of the ideas I just shared, I think, will really go a long way to earn. Are you talking about me personally or the department?
Well, considering that you're new to this community and from out of state, we don't really know you. So, for you personally.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I'm a stranger. So, you know, it's the same thing inside of the police department. Our police officers don't really know me either, but they do know of my track record. They know that I'm a trusted individual who has dedicated my life to public safety, starting with 8 years that I spent in the Marine Corps, so I appreciate that poster up there, by the way. I meant to share that with you. And then my 23 years in policing. So, always telling the truth and never making promises that you can't keep are the two things that have kept my reputation intact and have gained confidence and trust by my community that I serve. I intend to continue doing those two things. Beyond that, you all will just have to hold me accountable when I don't do my job to your satisfaction. You'll have to call me on the things that I haven't done well. I'll have to ask you to hold me responsible. And for that, I should gain your respect and your trust. That's a great question, by the way. Never been asked that.
We know right now you just discussed some of the ways you would like to earn respect, but another question we have is, once you've earned the respect and you've seen what you've done, outside of being a whole department, what are your personal goals to help achieve personalness? And like, when you're able to leave, when you're done with your position as chief, and you'll be able to look back and say, I did that for Salinas, what are some of the personal goals you have?
I hope to be here as your police chief for a very long time, because there's a lot of work ahead. It's gonna take me a long time to get these challenges accomplished. But on a personal level, I just need to continue to live my life in a way that my children can be proud of me. And personally, to spend more time with my family, meaning my exterior, my dad, my brothers and sisters when I retire, God willing. Personally, I have everything I want here in Salinas, so I don't plan on going anywhere. Thank you for that question.
So we do have some more time for questions, and I know there's a lot of pink slips that have been collected. I see them on all the desks here, so I'm going to challenge each of the ASB leaders to go through the pink slips that are on your desk and choose the one that you like the most, and we'll go in the same order. We'll start with the Vikings. So let's start with North Salinas High School. Kelly, are you ready? Give Kelly a shout out. Here we go.
So the questions that we have, they're kind of similar about training. So do Salinas police officers receive any medical training, like EMT? And are you open for CIT training?
Did everybody hear her? Do Salinas police officers receive any medical training or EMT training? And the answer is, I'm gonna go with no, but we do receive, we're certified in CPR and first aid. There are some restrictions to us doing anything on the medical side of the house. However, for CIT, am I open to CIT? Yes, several of our officers have been trained in crisis intervention. That is extremely important. Oh, all of them. I am so glad to have someone here from the department who could support that statement, because I thought that perhaps they were all CIT trained, but like I said, I don't want to make promises I don't keep, but I've just been told that they're all CIT trained.
Oh, sorry about that. Thank you very much, Chief. And now to Salinas High School. Rachel? Cole?
Okay. If a loved one from the LGBTQ community is being mistreated by an officer due to his or her gender, what can it be done about it? Will you make it a priority for your department to get LGBT sensitivity training in an effort to build rapport with the community?
LGBT training is something that, and diversity training is introduced to all police officers in the academy. I can't quote the exact number of hours of training that we receive in that specific area, but it is quite a bit, and it is state mandated. However, with any type of mistreatment, any type, we have a process, you know, that people can come to the police department or call in and they can let me hear their concerns or their complaint, and then we decide whether or not that needs to go to our internal affairs investigation, or if that is something that will be handled between the commander, the sergeant, and the officer who is being accused of wrongdoing. Cool.
Thank you very much. Okay, next up, Mount Toro.
Are the SPD willing to work with the Hispanic community without racism on the east side of Salinas?
Yes.
Do you want to elaborate on that a little bit?
So, well, let me just say, I guess it was my first week here. I asked one of our police department employees who is from the east side of Salinas to take me around and show me the town and give me some feedback as to where these hot spots, areas of war, have a lot of activity, a lot of criminal activity. And this person I thought did an excellent job showing me the ins and outs of the east side. And I've begun looking at areas where we can do some more work. I've been here only 1 month, so I can't commit to exactly what or how, but I'll tell you that I am looking at a way to decentralize our work so that we're not all stuffed into the headquarters of the police department every day, but we can spread out a little bit more and feel a little bit more accessible to all parts of the community, especially those that may feel disenfranchised. So one of the things that I like to look at and explain to officers is if a community says that they feel that they're not being treated right or treated fairly, and our department says firmly, no, that's not true. We treat everyone fairly, and we don't know what you're talking about. Then that's when I explain that the perception of people is valid, it's important. If they see it that way, then it is, right? So that is something that we are gonna work on, is spreading our wings a little bit, getting our tentacles out to the different parts of the community so that, for starters, we appear to be more accessible, and then, therefore, we shall be more accessible. Does that answer your question?
Great job. Thank you, Chief. And now on to Everett Alvarez High School. Marissa, Paige.
So, having lately benefited from the SPD Community Academy, I would like to know if something similar could be done for youth. I recognize the resources are limited. And then other questions also ask about the engagement of youth in the community.
The last little tag I missed.
It was, are you gonna implement any similar programs to the Salinas PD Community Academy?
So I have been part of this community policing academy experience for over 20 years. It's something that went on in the city where I grew up as a cop on the beat. And I know there is tremendous value. Whoever wrote this note, I acknowledge that there is tremendous value in having a community police academy. We will continue to do CPAs, and I'll take a look at them and see if there's room for any growth, for any additional topics. One of the things I like to do with young people is I like to have youth academies in the summer that target that group that don't want to be around us old parts. And so we kind of jazz it up and make it a little bit more youthful and bring particular topics in of interest for young adults and older teenagers. So yes, that is something I will be looking at doing. I'm not sure where our resources are for that right now, but I'm definitely going to look into providing a similar academy for young adults and older teens.
Gosh, great questions. Okay, Alice, Angel, Anna?
Might it be possible for all police officers to use 2 or 3 hours a week to tutor and help students?
Yes. It's possible. If you mean to suggest while they're on duty, at this time, I have to be perfectly honest with you and say no, that would not be possible at this time. Doing things like drop everything and read and invite our officers to come over to be a part of that is certainly something we can fit in, because we know that can be accomplished, you know, an hour here or 30 minutes here and there. But to take 2 to 3 hours out of a patrol officer's schedule is not realistic at this time. So I didn't want to start off my dialogue with you tonight on a negative, but it's probably past due that I mentioned some of the issues that we're experiencing internally, and that is our staffing issue. I'm sure you've all heard about it. Approximately a quarter of our staffing is vacant. So we currently have 131 officers, and we are authorized 172. So, yeah, 41 vacancies at this time. As a result, and as you might know, our former chief, McMillan, had pulled all of the specialized units and had to pour them back into the patrol division so that we could just have enough to answer basic calls in a reactive manner. So at this time, it's very, very challenging to do anything above patrol responses and investigations. But we are absolutely open to things like engagement with young people. But sitting there and reading and tutoring 2 to 3 hours sounds something closer to a volunteer program. And all of our officers are all, you know, like anyone else, are more than welcome and encouraged to volunteer.
Let's give the chief a round of applause. So, Chief Frese. You have a few minutes to just kind of offer some closing comments before we'll round out the event. So maybe 3 or 4 minutes, whatever you want to say, just kind of in conclusion, some of your observations and the questions today and some of the commentary.
Great. Thank you. First, I want to thank each and every one of you students who are here, who have just been very courageous to come up in front of your community and speak and ask very important and intelligent questions. I want to thank all of you for who have come out tonight. I want to encourage all of you to continue to come to community meetings. I think it's very important that I continue to hear feedback from each and every one of you. I'm going to work very hard to move these meetings closer to your homes. By that, I mean to, just kind of decentralizing everything we do. And that means, starting with me. I need to get out into the community. I need to learn all of the different points of this city and get more familiar with where people gather so that I can start asking people to host smaller venues, and that'll give us a chance to talk in smaller groups rather than, you know, this is great, this is wonderful. It really truly is fabulous, and I am so thankful that it was a summit. This is like a gift for me to get a large group of people under one roof. But eventually down the road, I would really like to meet with you in smaller groups in neighborhoods, at least for my first year. And I want to bring meeting officers with me, you know, whoever works in their area, wherever we hold these meetings. I want to bring the meet officer and perhaps the sergeant along with me to meet you, and so that you can meet them, and maybe in a different setting, or maybe for the first time that you've ever had a chance to meet one of your Salinas police officers. So I would like to ask you to challenge what you do that and to stay on course with coming to your neighborhoods so that I'm sure, be much more comfortable in a smaller setting. And my experience has been people are more likely to share information as well and bring up ideas than they, you know, in smaller settings rather than come before a podium like this. And I want to encourage you to talk to people and let me know what's going on. You guys are all here for a reason. So you've got something that you want to share. And whatever it is, I want you to know it will be valued, it will be respected, and I will continue to hear out our community one meeting at a time. And thank you very much.
Great job. I have some flowers for our new chief. I think she did a tremendous job. I just have to say, as we had a chance to visit, I was so impressed, not only with her commitment to public safety, as she's given so many decades, not just serving our country, but various communities. She comes with a definite new, fresh perspective, and you can tell the value she places on young people and on our community. So let's once again give Chief Frese a round of applause. It helps to be in the green business. You know, maybe just a couple of closing remarks here. Again, I want to thank the students. But before I get to all the students, because I do have the help of our favorite Viking, Kelly, here, our superintendent, Tim, is still here. Tim Finoli has done a great job running our high school district. And so we have a couple of flowers for you. To your staff, to your very committed advisors, and she's not going to be able to run fast enough with all these flowers, but we'll get them to them. Blanca at the district office, this wouldn't have happened if it weren't for her. The communication through the break, it's amazing we were able to gain so many students, so we want to definitely give her a round of applause. Blanca, thank you very much. And then to Dr. Llewellyn and to our friends with ASHC, thank you very much, Raphael. We have a parting gift for you as well. What a great host, and I can't tell you how enthusiastic Dr. Llewellyn was to make the connection between the student governments and the five public high schools, with our local community college, with the community, and with our police chief, and I just think it's wonderful. And then for each of our five schools, we have flowers for not just our student leadership, but for their advisors. Those advisors put a lot of hours in. So our mayor, Joe Gunter, would have loved to have been here tonight. He had another obligation, but I know he shares the vision that I do as a council member and a policymaker for a high regard for public safety. We spend more than half of our budget, nearly two-thirds of our budget, on public safety, and the lion's share is our hardworking men and women in uniform that are running the police department. And I can't tell you what a high level of respect I have for these men and women. Our police officers are so incredibly hardworking.
And it's largely because we are so understaffed. And so as a council and as a policymaker, we are working with the chief as fast as we can to get those community service officers and to get those uniformed sworn police officers out there so that we can be in the schools, so that we can respond faster and be proactive. I can't emphasize that enough. I think the chief's remarks to stay involved and to our ASP leadership and to our student leadership, this is only the beginning. Honestly, like, the city of Salinas needs you, and I can only make that calling. So whether it's to Cal Poly, or whether it's to Chico, or Hartnell, or UC Davis, we hope that you'll come back, because Salinas needs your leadership. There's no doubt about it. Us gray-haired folks won't be here forever. And to members of the public that got here today, I have some handy-dandy brochures with phone numbers and a lot of resources, and Inglés and Español, for you to call, so that if there is something that's going wrong with your home, your neighbors, your street, we know. Because if we don't know about it, we can't respond to it. So we really hope that this is a two-way street and everybody's as engaged as possible. Again, to Evelino with this great idea, to the advisors and to the students that embrace this, I can't thank you enough for coming out on Monday night. And I can only hope that we'll do this again. You heard from the chief. She would love another invitation, whether it's a neighborhood group, whether it's a student group. Let's let this be the beginning of a long relationship with our Salinas Police Department. So I want to thank everybody for coming out. We'll stick around for a while. The chief would love to answer some more questions. I'm sorry we didn't get to them all, but wasn't this a great exercise for our young adults in student government and for the community? I'm just really proud of how everybody handled themselves. Really, this could have gone better. So I just want to thank everybody for coming out, and hopefully you'll stick around, and thank you very much.